Good morning. It's good to see everyone today, be together again, enjoy our fellowship with each other, and study more of God's Word. Brother David will be talking to us in just a few minutes and continue to talk to us about God's love and lay up treasures in heaven. We look forward to that. Brother Brian Forbes will lead us in our song service this morning. Brother Scott Beard will be wording our scripture, reading our scripture, and wording our opening prayer for us. Let's all now join together and make a joyful noise to our Lord and let Him know we truly love Him. Thank you, Brian.
Number 138. We'll sing verses 1, 3, and 4. Tempted and tried, we're oft made to wonder why it should be thus all the day long. While there are others living about us, never molested, though in the wrong. Farther along, we'll know all about it. Farther along, we'll understand why. Cheer up, my brother. We'll understand it all by and by. Faithful till death, said our loving Master, a few more days to labor and wait. Toils of the road will then seem as nothing as we sweep through the beautiful gate. Farther along, we'll know all about it. Farther along, we'll understand why. Cheer up, my brother, live in the sunshine. We'll understand it all by and by. When we see Jesus coming in glory, when He comes from His home in the sky, then we shall meet Him in that bright mansion. We'll understand it all by and by. Farther along, we'll know all about it. Farther along, we'll understand why. Cheer up, my brother, live in the sun. We'll understand it all by and by. Our song before our scripture reading and prayer this morning, number 359. 359, we'll sing verses 1, 2, and 4. Jesus, keep me near the cross, there a precious fountain, free to all a healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain. In the cross, in the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river. Near the cross, a trembling soul
Scripture reading this morning, but will be taken from Ephesians chapter 4, verses 25 through 32. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 25 through 32. Wherefore, putting away lying, speak every man truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. Be ye angry and sin not, let not the sun go down upon your wrath, neither give place to the devil. Let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor, working with his hands the thing which is good, that he may live to give to him that needeth. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be ye kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. Let us pray. Dear Father, we thank you for this another day of life you've given us, Father. We thank you for all the blessings that come from you, and we thank you for this opportunity that you've given us to come worship you here today. And we pray that we worship you according to your word, and worship according to your will, Father, and that we study your word each and every day and bring others to Christ, and help us to give us wisdom of your word, and help us to bring our families to Christ and one day be with you in heaven, Father. Father, we pray for the elders here and the ministers here, the deacons, that we work for you and get the gospel out to all of the world and community here in Jackson and West Tennessee. And we pray that you give every one of them wisdom and understanding. We pray for the ones that are sick here, the ones that have been sick, recovering from illness, Father. We realize that we're in the middle of a pandemic and there's a lot of anxiety, a lot of worry. We pray that you would comfort the ones that are the doctors that are ministering to them, the ones that may be in the hospital. We pray that you would be with us and help us to focus on you, Father, and that one day our goal here on this earth is to work for you and to bring others to you and be with you in heaven and to serve you and work for you one day, Father, in all joyfulness and gladness. Father, we pray for the ones that have lost loved ones. We've lost a lot of loved ones this month in October, lots of members here, the congregation in the past several months. We pray that you would comfort them and comfort their families and help us to comfort one another, Father. And we pray that you would got election coming up this year, and we realize that all leaders of the world are put in place because of you, Father, and allow things to happen. And we pray that you would guide the leaders of the world. And there's a lot of protesting now, Father, a lot of people that seem like they want to put their agendas first. And we've studied several lessons the past several weeks and heard a lot of things about how we shouldn't put our agendas first, and we pray that you would help us to put others first, Father, and help us to serve others. And Father, we pray that you would be with us through this week and help us be shining examples in the community and help us not to sin, for we all sin and fall short in your glory, and that you forgive us of our sins when we do sins and ask forgiveness for our sins. Pray that you'd be with each one of us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Psalm before Brother David's lesson this morning will be number 684. 684. We'll sing all three verses. This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. They're all expecting me, and that's one thing I know. My Savior pardoned me, and now I onward go. I know he'll take me through, though I am weak and poor, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Just up in glory land we'll live eternally. The saints on every hand are shouting victory. Their songs of sweetest praise drift back from heaven's shore, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore.
Good morning. Yeah, it's so good to see you here this morning. Brian, thank you for those hymns, and especially that last hymn. What a great thought, and what a wonderful hope, and so appropriate for our lesson this morning. I appreciate Scott Beard so much, the great work that he does here as one of our deacons. And I appreciate Brian and John. Thank you for your warm welcome. Josh and Christy are away today with the children. in Michigan in a gospel meeting, so let's please remember them. And a special thanks to Chad and Rose Banks for another outstanding truck or treat event yesterday. And a big thank you to our youth group for all the carnival games that they made available to all the children. And as a grandfather, I can tell you, we really appreciated the effort, and it was a lot of fun. Even though it was a little cold, the fellowship was really warm. It's the eighth of the Ten Commandments, you shall not steal. But of all the Ten Commandments, this is the one that perhaps we think about the least. It has actually been called the forgotten commandment. It's easy to overlook it. It's even easier to break it. But it's high time that we remembered it. Let's talk about it. I read recently the story of a man in a Soviet factory who attempted to steal items from his workplace. Every day he filled his wheelbarrow with cylinders, iron ore, and tools. And every day as he left, he got caught and the stuff was taken away from him. Finally, he was fired, and on his last day, the commissar waited for him to come out with the contraband. When he arrived at the door, the commissar pulled back the cover from the wheelbarrow, and there, sure enough, was everything that he had taken, the usual stuff. He confiscated everything, and he said to the thief, "You are a fool. We caught you every single day. You got away with nothing." "Commissar, sir," he replied, "you are the fool. I've been stealing wheelbarrows." Well, it's not a joke, though, is it? When you are the victim of robbery. It was a Saturday autumn morning. A beautiful morning, about this time of year, when someone broke into our car right there in our carport and stole Kathy's purse. They broke the window, grabbed the purse, and ran. We did all the usual things. You cancel your credit cards, you stop the checking account. We lost a little cash, but after all, not a lot of cash because we're a preacher's family. There wasn't really anything else in the purse of great value except two rings. One wedding ring that her father had given to her mother, and a second wedding band that her grandfather had given to her grandmother, the grandmother on her father's side that she had never met because she passed away before Kathy was born. The insurance company told us that the rings weren't worth much, but the sentimental value of those rings was priceless. We never did find the purse or the rings. It didn't happen like it happens with a lot of people. You come home and you realize someone has actually been in your house and someone who's gone through all of your stuff. But nevertheless, we felt violated. And if you've ever been the victim of a robbery, you know what that experience is like. And I can remember seeing a stranger walking down the street in our neighborhood and wondering, is that the robber or is that a potential robber? And it still is hard to get over. I still think about that morning. I still think about that day. Stealing is defined simply as somebody else's property being taken by someone else without that person's knowledge or permission. And in the United States, property theft occurs in some form every 3 seconds. So we're not alone. None of us is alone. What we've been trying to do in looking at God loving us is trying to look at the Ten Commandments in that context. This is where we've gotten thus far with our Ten Commandments. Perhaps a positive spin on the Ten Commandments if we can do that. And I think we can. The Bible does tell us in Deuteronomy 33, verse 2, that God delivered that law with great fire. But he did so, the very next verse says, out of his heart of love. So God loves us, and even in the Ten Commandments, he demonstrates that to us. So we've looked at these thus far. Love God exclusively. Listen to God only. Lift up his name in adoration. Leave time for God. Live to honor your parents. Life is precious to God. Be loyal to your wedding vows. And 8 this morning, lay up treasure in heaven. God is love, and God loves us, and he proves that to us day after day by giving us something to do, something to own, and something to give. And he loves us enough to warn us and others that it is wrong to take that which he has given to others that rightfully then belongs to them. This 8th commandment is found first in Exodus 20, verse 15, but then again in Deuteronomy 5, verse 19. In the passage that was read for us just a moment ago, in verse 24, leading into this verse, you have the contrast between the old man of the past and the new man of the present or the future. This is the conversion of a sinner to a saint. When you come to verse 28, the 8th commandment then rears its head again, and we're reminded of it once more. Let him who stole steal no longer, but rather let him labor, working with his hands. What is good? What is good? That we labor with our own hands, that we don't take from others what rightfully belongs to them, that doesn't belong to us. And then that he may have something to give him who has need. So it is good what God has done for us. And it is even good when God prohibits stealing. From this passage in Ephesians 4, I'd like to make 3 observations rather quickly. Number 1, as we think about this idea of you shall not steal, and we think about how God loves us and how God has blessed us, first of all, let's consider leaning on his promises. It is true there's such a thing as stealing because there's such a thing as ownership. God dignifies us, his children, by giving us 1, work to perform, property, 2, to maintain, and rights, 3, to uphold. These principles, I think, are well laid out in creation. And if you think about all of these 10 commandments, find their foundation in creation from the very beginning. So these are laws, if you will, that are intrinsically valuable. They're right. They'll always be right. They'll never be wrong, or they'll never be a part of living a godly life. So when you look at creation, especially Genesis chapter 2, notice in verse 8 that God provided man with a garden in which to live. 2, he gave him a job to tend and keep that garden, verse 15. And then he gave him a responsibility, 3. That responsibility was naming every one of the animals in verse 19. And then he blessed him with abundant fruit or food from all the trees in the Garden of Eden, including the tree of life, with the exception of the one tree in verses 16 and 17, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. God is the true owner of all things. As Exodus 19:5 says, all the earth is mine. And that chapter is right before the giving of the Ten Commandments. In Psalm 24, verse 1, David says, the earth is the Lord's and all its fullness, the world and those who dwell therein. And I love the words of Psalm 50, verse 10, the cattle on 1,000 hills belong to God. I can never look out across a pasture and not see cows grazing without thinking that all those cows ultimately belong to God, but God has given them to us. He has blessed us with them. I love Matthew 6, verse 8, when Jesus was talking about prayer, and he contrasted an unbeliever with a believer. He says, therefore, do not be like them. That is the unbeliever who doesn't believe that his prayers are going to be answered. That's why he's an unbeliever. For your Father knows the things you have need of before you ask him. And then I think of the beautiful words in Matthew chapter 6, verses 31 through 34. In the very context of people who worried about what they were going to eat, what they were going to drink, what they were going to wear, where they were going to live, where they were going to make a living. Therefore, do not worry, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For after all these things, the Gentiles, the unbelievers, the worldly folks seek. For your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things, but seek first the kingdom of God, or the church, and his righteousness, that's God's righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. And can we not add to his righteousness these Ten Commandments? I believe we can. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about the things or its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. And so Jesus promises us that God will take care of us if we'll but trust him. And that's what this commandment is actually saying. God is asking us very simply, can you trust me to provide for you? I will meet your every need, and I've given you a way to grow and find great satisfaction in acquiring your property through honest work. How will you feel about yourself if you get caught up in a cycle of taking what isn't yours? I don't want that for you, and thus I have said, you shall not steal. I don't want you to feel responsible for securing all of this for yourself. If you'll trust me, I will help you, and you won't have to steal to get what you need. Let me illustrate it this way. Let's say that I gave Katie, my six-year-old daughter at the time, a shiny new bike for her birthday. And I did that because I loved her. But then a neighborhood bully came along and pushed her down and stole her bike. How do you think I would feel? Well, my first impulse would be to kill him. You can't do that. That's illegal. But I would be very angry, and so would you if you were in my place. We would be offended, and we would be angry that someone took away part of our voice that we had used to say to our daughter that we love so much, I love you. God's provisions are a daily voice to you and me that says, I love you. And for that reason, he prohibits anyone from silencing his voice by stealing. So at the very heart of stealing is a lack of faith in God. So number one, may God help us to lean on his promises. But number two, may God help us to labor with our own hands. These commandments in Exodus 20 and Deuteronomy chapter 5, this one in particular, you shall not steal, is very much like the two that preceded it. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. In the Hebrew language, each of these commandments is just two Hebrew words each. So it's pretty simple. It's really straightforward. And it hits us right where we live, I believe. Every day, the news brings us stories about car theft, white-collar theft, armed robbery, muggings, shoplifting, insurance fraud, income tax evasion, breaking and entering, embezzlement, employee theft, a pyramid get-rich-quick scheme, many of them, extortion, blackmail, bribery, and all of the rest of the sophisticated means we use to rip each other off every single day. And we're paying for it as well. For example, Retailers estimate that the annual cost of shoplifting in America to be a whopping $10 to $50 billion. Your family and mine will spend $300 this year in extra cost because of someone else's shoplifting. America has clearly forgotten the Eighth Commandment. But before we get started and begin to think that this commandment somehow doesn't have anything to do with us, or I start thinking it doesn't have anything to do with me, I've come to realize, and often too late, that I have been guilty of stealing too. I have stolen time before. And time is the most precious commodity that we own, and once it is gone, we cannot get it back. And it is true that stealing can even take place in the church building, can even take place in the assemblies. Malachi 3, verse 8, asks the very sobering question, will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. But you say, in what way have we robbed you? In tithes and offerings. And so even this commandment addresses good people, even religious people. We all have to pay attention to that eighth commandment, you shall not steal. I think it may help us if we're to understand how this commandment actually fits into our society. Because God gave us this commandment, I think, to accomplish three things as a society. One, to provide stability in our society. Two, to teach respect for private property or the property of others. And then I think three, most importantly, to promote honesty, hard work, and thrift, or saving responsibly. Ephesians 4:28 says it pretty plainly, doesn't it? Let him who stole steal no more. And then I think about the sobering words of 1 Corinthians 6, verses 9 and 10. Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. So right in the midst of all of those hideous sexual sins, you find stealing. And those who are punished for these other sins that we consider to be greater sins is the same. They're punished as well. Thieves are punished just as fornicators or adulterers or homosexuals. And when you see them side by side, thieves and covetous, they go hand in hand, don't they? We steal what we covet, what we don't have, what we desire to have. If we can't get it, if we can't buy it, if someone isn't willing to give it to us, we'll just take it if we really want it. But understand that with God, there is a high price to pay for stealing. Think of Achan in the Old Testament in Joshua 7, who stole property that belonged ultimately to God. Or think about Judas in John chapter 12, verse 6, who had the money bag for the apostles, but he was a thief. He was stealing from it daily. Little wonder then that he would sell out the Lord for 30 pieces of silver. And I think of Zacchaeus, who was that crooked little tax collector, in Luke 19, verse 8, but give him credit. Zacchaeus said, if I've stolen from anyone, and he had, I will repay it with great interest. And so there's a price to be paid for not working with my own hands, but taking from others what rightfully belongs to them and does not belong to me. The United States seems to have become lately a nation of the freebie, and the handout, and whatever I can do to get as much as I possibly can get without having to work for it. That's not what built this country. That's not what made this country great. It's not what will make this country great still. Dr. James Dobson, who's the founder of Focus on the Family, told the story once of playing Monopoly with his family. They played late into the night, and James Dobson said he was killing everybody. He owned Broadwalk and Park Place. He had hotels on all of them. He owned all four of the railroads, and he had them piled high and stacked high as well. Every time you went around the board, you had to pay him. After a while, he had it all. He had it all stacked up neatly in front of him. He had just literally wiped out everybody. And so everybody was mad at him. Everybody got angry, got up from the table, and went to bed. He said, I sat there and I looked at that pile of play money. And I looked at all my little toys in front of me. I was the winner. But really, he said, I was the loser. Because the time came when I had to put it all back in the box. I thought to myself, isn't that like life? We spend all of our lives getting it all, getting it away from everybody else. And when it's all over, one, they don't like us. And two, we have to put it all back in the box. It's hard to imagine, isn't it? A world in which we live, where there would be no one violating the eighth commandment, but people actually obeying this commandment. Just think about it. There would be no securities fraud. There would be no tax fraud. There would be no insurance fraud. There would be no investment fraud. There would be no insurance fraud. There would be no investment fraud. There would be no computer fraud, no identity theft, no music fraud, no plagiarism, which, by the way, the Latin word for plagiarism means to kidnap. No shoplifting and no one breaking into your house or car to help themselves to your property. It would be as it had always been intended to be from the very beginning. Everyone working with his own hands, doing that which is good, not only for themselves, but for everyone else. Just think about it. A world in which people owed no one except to love one another. Romans 13:9. One, may God help us to lean on his promises. Two, may God help us to labor with our own hands. And three, may God give us the wisdom to lay up treasure in heaven. Jesus said it first, do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break through and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasure in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break through and steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. And so the challenge is that we not only work and get, but we give. That which God has blessed us with, we give back to him in return in a myriad of different ways. Not only for his work, but also to help those around us who are in need. It's by giving that we experience what our Lord talked about in Luke 6, verse 38. Jesus said, give and it shall be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over will be put into your bosom. For with the same measure that you use, it will be measured back to you. And I think about the psalmist in Psalm 23, where the psalmist says in Psalm 23, verse 5, my cup runneth over, and in giving we receive so much more than we ever imagined we could have or possess. Can Ephesians 4:28 really help us to honor the eighth commandment? Why did I choose that verse? Let me give you these three reasons. Let him who stole steal no more. That is, be honest is what the Bible is saying. Honesty. Number two, let him work with his hands, his own hands. That's industry. And then charity. Let him who has give to him who does not have. In other words, you've got all three principles, honesty, industry, and charity, all the values that really matter to us in this life. It's really very simple. Paul is simply saying, stop stealing, start working, and give instead of taking. And when we give instead of taking, I think it shows not only love for others, but it also shows our great faith in God that He will provide for us. Someone once said, when you give something away, you're not losing it, you're investing it. When you keep something for yourself, you're not really keeping it. You're only postponing the time when you will ultimately lose it. When I was younger, I never understood that. It's funny, the older you get, the more you realize your collections really don't matter that much. Acts 20, verse 35, when Jesus said it's more blessed to give than to receive, he was so right. But you know, you can't give that which you don't have. And the reason we have brings us back to God's great love for us, because he blesses us again and again and again every single day. I thought about this. What makes North Jackson such a great place, such a great family, such a great place in which to belong? Our elders, our leadership, our programs, like our visitation program, like our youth program, like our Dorcas ministry, like our great Bible teachers. And oftentimes I've described North Jackson as a country church feel in the city. There's so many things you could list. But to me, what really truly makes North Jackson an amazing place is its generosity. Even in the midst of a pandemic, have you noticed? We've not only met our budget, we've exceeded it. God's been good to us. He's blessed us immeasurably. 73% then of that budget is funneled into some form of evangelism or benevolence. We're a part of that great work. And if that were not enough, what about the special additional contributions that are beyond and above our budget? The money just keeps pouring in. I don't know where you're getting it, but you're very kind and generous with it. And we're able to help so many people in so many different places. And the name North Jackson goes with each gift and with each receiving of that gift. A blessing is measured out by a God who loves us, a God who gave us that opportunity. We seized it, but he opened that door for us. God is good, and when God says, you shall not steal, it isn't negative. It isn't to kill all the joy or rob all the joy in our lives. It's to express to us how much he truly has blessed us and how protective he is of that which he has blessed us with. I remember a story that I read not long ago about a rabbi who was asked about a natural disaster, and the young man asked him, how in the world could God allow something like that? How in the world could he, that is the rabbi, ever explain this tragic act of God? The rabbi answered, the disaster was an act of nature. The act of God occurred when people stepped up to help each other. Reminds me of a story, another story that I found in preparation for this lesson about Maxie Jarman. Maxie Jarman was the founder of the great Gnesco shoe chain. And over the years, Jarman was an incredible philanthropist. He gave away millions of dollars to his charities and to help other people, to feed other people, to give them clean water in countries where they could not find any. But the day came when his company collapsed, and with it his personal fortune. Someone asked him, Mr. Jarman, don't you regret giving all that money away? Think about what a difference it would make if you had it all back. To which he replied, oh no, I don't regret any of the money I have given away. After all, I only lost what I kept for myself. What a fantastic perspective on life. I only lost what I kept for myself. The Bible says, stop stealing, start working, and give instead of get. God will take care of us, and we will be the happier for it. Now, as we come to a close, what do we do? I guess the only question that remains is, can God forgive a thief? You know, I remember when Jesus was dying, and you do too, the last man who asked him for forgiveness, Jesus granted it, was a thief. Today, he said to him, you shall be with me in paradise. Luke 23, verse 43. Those are remarkable words because Jesus didn't say them to a good man or to a religious man, but he said them to a thief who was paying the ultimate price for his thievery. Can a thief be saved? Absolutely. Can you be saved? Can I be saved? It's only Christ who can transform a burglar into a benefactor, someone once said. Isaiah 53, verse 12 says that Jesus was numbered among the transgressors. Here's a simple way of saying that Jesus was numbered with the thieves so that he could save a thief like me. And be kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, hath forgiven you. The words of Ephesians 4, 32. So this morning, are your sins forgiven? Have they been washed away by the blood of Christ? Have you been baptized for the remission of your sins? Or if you're here this morning and you are a Christian, how much time have you stolen from God? How much time have we wasted in his service? Time he gave to us and time he anticipated we would do the most with it. If you're here this morning and you need to make your life right with God for whatever reason, don't let anything stand in the way of your coming while together we stand and sing.
Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? In the soul. nothing white as snow. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Be seated, please.
Does everyone have your bag with communion in it? If you do not have one, please raise your hand. One of our ushers will get one to you. Pray with me. Father, we're grateful to you for Christ and his sacrifice at Calvary. We're grateful to you, Father, for his body that was broken for our sins. At this time, Father, as we partake of the bread, we pray that we would do so in a way and manner that's pleasing to you. In Christ's name, amen. Once again, our Heavenly Father, we're grateful to you for Christ and his sacrifice at Calvary. We're thankful, Father, for the blood that gives us the cleansing from our sins. We pray, Father, at this time as we partake of this fruit of the vine, that we will do so in a way and manner that's pleasing to you, always remembering the cruel death that he died for us. In his name we pray. Amen.
Brother David, as always, thank you so much for the way with which you are able to break the bread of life to us, give us hope of eternal life with our brothers and sisters in Christ in heaven. We look forward to tonight's lesson. We invite everybody to come back. If you're visiting with us today, thank you for being here. We are happy that you're here, and we want you to come back each time you have an opportunity. You'll always be welcome. We have several announcements this morning, many of which concern our families that have lost loved ones. We have seven families that we need to remember. Bob Bracken lost his sister, Lucretia Strice. She passed away October the 19th, and services were yesterday in Parsons, Kansas for her. Lydia Branch passed away October the 19th. She is the grandmother of Sister Angela Moss and the aunt of Sister Deborah Beach, and services were yesterday in Camden, Tennessee for her. Kaylin Stratton's grandfather, Dean Bush, passed away October the 17th. Services were this past Thursday in Waverly, Tennessee for him. Also, Sister Janelle Waddell's brother, Jimmy McLean, passed away October 19th, and services were in McKenzie this past Thursday for him. Also, most recently in the past, Brother Scott Chandler in the loss of his father, Jimmy Chandler, and their family. Steve and Emily Crabtree and Josh and Jarrett Hersker in the loss of Karen Crabtree, who was the daughter of Sandra and Emily, Steve and Emily, and the mother of Josh and Jerry. Let's remember that family especially. Sandra Witherspoon lost her father recently, Stuart Lukes. Please remember these families in your prayers, and as well as the others that we are aware of that are sick and struggling with many different things here in this life, as David mentioned. Daylight saving time is next Saturday evening, the 31st. Don't forget to roll your clocks back 1 hour, and we'll all be on time and hopefully meet that Sunday morning again together. Rebuilding and restoring Nehemiah's burden will be our topic of discussion tonight. We invite everybody to come back. Let's all please do that. If there's nothing else, we'll have our closing song, and Brother Al will pray for our contributions that may be given and close us in prayer. Is there anything we need to mention? If not, let's all be standing for our closing song.
O
land of rest, for thee I sigh. When will the moment come when I shall lay my armor by and dwell in peace at home? We'll work till Jesus comes. We'll work till Jesus comes. We'll work till Jesus comes, and we'll be gathered home.
Holy Father, we're grateful to you for the day you've given us, for the privilege of coming together with your people. Thank you, Father, for the wonderful message we've heard. We pray that we can live it in our lives, and the people in our community can see Christ in us. Help us, Father, know that all good blessings come for you, and think about those things as we return a portion of those things to you. Go with us through the afternoon. In Christ's name, amen.